agreement. Thank you guys for having us tonight and for making the time. I run the mayor's bike program, I'm the director of Boston Bikes. And we have Vinny Gupta here. He is in Transportation Department, Boston Transportation. He's the director of transportation planning. And presenting tonight will be our consultants from Tool Design Group, Nick Jackson and Michelle Danilla. What we want to talk to you about is a plan for a proposed bike lane in the North End. It would be the first bike lane to come to the North End. As part of the mayor's bike programs, we've had bike lanes in just about every neighborhood installed at this point. And it's part of a broader effort to create a really vibrant and livable city, a place where people are outside where they don't need their cars, and they can get around by any means of transportation. What's really unique about the proposal for Commercial Street and Atlantic Avenue is we came up with a concept called Harbor Bike, where what we're actually creating is an extension of your park in many ways. And it's the ability to create a facility that's really family friendly, where kids could bike with their parents, grandparents, anyone could bike. And a main part of the mayor's bike program is to figure out not how do we support existing cyclists who are wearing spandex and flying through all the red light, but how do we really transform the city? And the mayor's goal is make it a world-class bicycling city. And if you really see world-class biking cities, it's the everyday person biking. It's anyone in this room. It's not cyclists and spandex. But when you see kids out, when you see women out, when you see grandparents, that's the direction we're going. At the end of this month, we're getting ready to launch Bike Share. And it's been kind of transformative all over the world. And we're pretty excited to have it. We'll have a station in the North End, and we'll talk about that in 2 seconds. But that's really one of the giant steps forward in terms of getting the average person on bikes. And what we've seen with Bike Share is these are not cyclists that bike. It's people that always said, well, I would like to, or I bring my bike to the Cape with me when I go on vacation. And now they have a way to bike. We heard fairly loud and clear the original location we had proposed for the North End is not really well liked. It was at 99 Commercial Street or Atlantic Avenue. Commercial? Well, it's changed.
That's where it was.
Yeah, so the old location people didn't like. We got a few suggestions. We're actually moving it to a new site nearby. It is still near the Lewis Wharf area, Pilot Wharf, near the Barr Foundation, essentially, who's helping us bring that to the North End. So we'll present that later, and it seems like a site that's much more in tune with all the comments that we got back. So let me just ask you, what is the ideal time for us to talk before questions?
Just, you need about a half hour to start, right?
We'll have a half hour, so we'll have you guys talk for 10, 12 minutes.
Okay.
And then we'll take as many questions as you want. Interrupt any time. This is obviously about getting information to all of you.
Okay.
To
the point. Okay, my name's Nick Jackson, and this is Michelle Danella. The topic is bicycle facilities on commercial land. So the quick outline of the presentation, we'll talk about the goals of the project, we'll talk about the limits, talk a little bit about the data that Boston Bikes has collected, and then quickly review the existing conditions, and then the proposed options we've looked at, and finally open up for discussion. So the goals of this project, the city is adopting a complete streets approach to its streets, which means they need to work for all the users, pedestrians, motorists, bicyclists, and others. Our goals of this project are also to increase safety for bicyclists as well as other users. We want to increase connectivity. It's also important that we maintain adequate traffic capacity and minimize parking impacts. And finally, we're not posing to move curbs. This is a retrofit project with signs and markings primarily. So this is a quick snapshot of the city's kind of growing bicycle network. Blue are the existing bike lanes the city has been installing. The purple are lanes that are in design, likely moving forward this year, including downtown and along the greenway shown here. And then so our project, looking at again Atlantic and Commercial. And then we have we're meeting up with another project that's being led by the BRA on Causeway Street that we'll be coordinating with at the end of our project. As Nicole mentioned, there's the concept of Harbor Bike, looking at a continuous facility along the edge of the water, see outlined there in that orange color. So why do we look at designing streets for bicycles? Some of the basic reasons. One, it helps organize traffic and reduce conflicts between different modes when they have their own space. We also know that bike facilities increase traffic compliance. Bicycles are more likely to obey traffic controls after the installation of bikeways. They also decrease wrong-way riding and decrease riding on sidewalks, and that's an important consideration. We also know they increase general awareness of bicycles using the streets, which can lead to better safety. And finally, they've been shown to encourage bicycle use, which is an important policy goal of the city. Just a quick snapshot of some facilities. I'm going to talk with more, a little more. This is a standard bike lane, creating space for bicycles by using paint and symbols and signs. This is a very minimal treatment. This is a shared lane, not very comfortable to most new cyclists, maybe works for a more advanced commuter. And on the right, we have some more innovative facilities that I think Nicole alluded to that are attractive more to families, children, people who are less comfortable riding in mixed higher speed traffic. This is a one-way cycle track. These cars are parked. We call this a protected cycle track. And here is a two-way facility. In this case, protected with flexible bollards. So this is a survey done by the city. And what it does is it tells us the preference for different facility types by bicyclists. On the left here is that shared lane. We'll see which score is down at the bottom. As we add more protection, we get more and more favorable responses. So here's your shared lane down the left. Here's your bike lane, different bike lane options. Then all in the right, we have your protected bike lane, which is a cycle track, is close to an off-road path in terms of preference for cyclists. So that gives a sense of what cyclists and new people are looking for bikeways. We know that bicycling is increasing in Boston. It's growing. As you can see, we're growing at a faster rate than the rest of the country. So here you can see the growth in bicycling in Boston over the past few years. Another data point, the city asked bicyclists to map where they rode in a given day. They traced these routes. You obviously see a lot of heavy lines, thick oral lines, where a lot of lines were drawn over the bridges, only way into the city. And then here also, just to point out, here we have people currently using commercial and Atlantic. Okay, so this is the existing conditions. And we look at what's possible with the existing conditions. And as you can see now, we have parking on both sides of the street, two travelings out of direction, and sidewalks that range from 7 feet up to much wider in some cases. And the lanes are already relatively narrow, so there is no way to create a dedicated bikeway on the street without looking at moving either parking or travel lanes. So that led us to the next phase of our analysis to look at our options. I'm going to turn over to Michelle, who's going to go through that data.
I'm going to stay over here because I'll keep it all. So we did a survey along the route and
I'll get the pointer.
and surveyed all the parking spaces. We're aware parking in the north end is, as you've talked about tonight, is important. So we're not proposing to remove the parking. Parking on the side. So this is just the rest of the corridor. We did do a total number of parking spaces. There's 231 total parking spaces between Hall and Cross Street, and 142 of them are full-time resident spaces.
172,
thank you. So after we realized we were not going to remove a parking lane, we looked at removing a travel lane. So in order to do this, standard practice is you study the existing signalized intersections, and they are graded with an LOS, a level of service, which is grading from A to F. Obviously, A is the best, F being the worst. So we had 8 study area signalized intersections from Cross to Charter, and we determined the impacts with adding a bike lane and removing 1 travel lane. So here, it might be hard to read, and I apologize. Up at the top,
I'm really tall.
Just to orient you, and down at the bottom is Christopher Columbus Park. So you can see all the way around is the gutter grades, and this is existing versus proposed. So in the proposed condition, we have dropped 1 southbound travel lane. So there's 2 northbound travel lanes and 1 southbound travel lane. And the proposed letter grades at one intersection drops from an A to a B. They're B, 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 A, A, C. So they do not drop to below unacceptable levels of service, and that's the AM, if you want to go to the next slide. The PM is the same, B, 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 A, and C. Yep. So just in conclusion, the existing level of service is acceptable at all intersections, and the removing of a southbound does not impact traffic operations. They will still continue to operate at acceptable level of service. Turn it back to you.
So I just want to get back and talk about our initial concepts and talk about the impacts they would have on this corridor. So we looked at initially at three concepts, the one-way protected cycle track, the standard bicycle lanes, those provided in both directions, and then the two-way side path on one side of the street also protected. So again, here is the cycle track showing a two-way protected cycle track on both sides of the street, and with dropping one travel lane in southbound direction. And I'll talk more later, but as you can see, there are parking impacts at the corners, at the intersections, at the driveways. Because the bicycles are behind the parked cars, at intersections we recommend restricting parking so cars and bicycles can see each other. And this is a design practice that's been developed to make those intersections safer. This is a standard bicycle lane. You can see here we have bicycle lane in one direction, bicycle lane in the other. And because the bicycle lanes are not protected, you don't have parking impacts. The challenge with this is you do have double parking in some places that will block the bicycle lane. And then finally, the side path concept. And again, here you can see here's the two-way side path on one side of the street only. And here again, we have issues at the driveways where turning vehicles need to be able to see bicycles and bicycles need to be able to see drivers. But that was kind of a quick run through. A summary, all of them revolve moving one southbound travel lane. As we said, they all have minor level of service changes with an acceptable level. The parking impacts do vary. The two-way cycle track would require approximately 40 parking spaces. With the bicycle lane, there's no reduction in parking. And now with the side path on one side of the street, approximately 30 spaces would need to be removed to provide that safe visibility at corners. And then the other thing we looked at is issues with pickup, drop-off, and loading. On the cycle track and the side path, that would be shifted away from the curb. Those activities could still stay the same as they are today, except they'd be shifted off the curb.
So we presented to a number of different groups in the North End, and we've had a couple of public meetings. And one thing that came out was, isn't there something we can do that removes less parking but still creates that harbor bike concept that still appeals to families and really gets at the average person and not just a cyclist? And as you can see, the thing with the standard bike lane is the cyclist is right next to the traveling car, so not it's a smaller percentage of people that will feel comfortable biking. The second we add the protection, you've got the cars as the buffer, and so many more people feel comfortable. One of the concepts that came up over and over in some of these early conversations was a hybrid. Could we have a protected bike lane on the water side, hence Harbor Bike, and a standard bike lane on the other side? So we came back, we had these guys design it. The answer is yes, it can be designed. It has, we'll look at the impacts in a second. Again, you still remove the southbound travel lane. Again, you don't have the impacts on the level of service for driving. It reduces a lot less parking spaces, the 15 to 20 instead of the 30 or 40. We've worked through a lot of these pickup, drop-off, loading issues, and we'll talk about that soon. So this I'm sure you guys can all read from there, is that right? It's okay. What this is in our conversations, we've identified and you've helped us identify a lot of the issues of concern. And we made a big point of responding to each of those.
I think you made a mistake on the last slide. I think you said 15 to 20 parking spots, if I remember from the forum.
Nick, we'll talk about
seen
that.
Yes, we did. Since our last meeting, we've done more detailed design on the hybrid concept. And one thing we look closely at is concerns about the driveways. So we're actually going to recommend for a safe option to remove parking at the driveways. And that's the difference that we've discovered in the parking spaces. So the hybrid concept, we had estimated 5 to 10 spaces in our previous presentation. We revised that estimate to 15 to 20.
So the 5 to 10 is now gone to 15 to 20.
So
yep.
It's going to be 15 to 20 parking spaces that's going to be removed?
That's the hybrid concept that we've shown. That's our estimate for that option.
There's a lot of meeting once it was down to like 5 to 10 spaces.
5 to 8, Tuesday.
Yeah, no, so we've gone back and done more work, we've done, we've laid out the detailed design, and we have a revised number. We wanted to change that and let you know. Discussion. I don't know if you want to go through these individually at this point, we can share the list.
Do you want us to run through this, some of the concerns?
That's important, but it talks, we should do that.
Okay, one of the issues we heard right from the front is what happens with the funeral parking? It's sort of essential that people can double park there. And we don't propose any impacts on the funeral parking. We expect that people will still be allowed to park as they normally do.
How would that not affect, I mean, if you're eliminating a lane and then people are double parked and you still need room for a bike lane, how would that not affect the funeral parking?
The parking or the travel lane reduction is from Cross South, or sorry, Charter South. So it's from Charter to Cross Street is the travel lane reduction, and the parking, the travel lane in front of the funeral home will remain the same. So it's between, actually three lanes today.
Between Charter and North Washington, would it be the same lanes that you have today?
Yes.
So where would the people go that want bicycles?
That section will be redone with the Crossroads project. And under this condition, it'll be a shared road. We'll be putting the shared lane markings.
Sharing it with vehicles.
Yeah. Yeah, the last block transitions essentially to the shared lane marking. Once Crossroads is finished, we can help the cyclists get onto the path.
And also on the cell phone,
that's yeah.
You're asking about questions. Wait, let's finish.
Yeah. Okay. So double parking in front of the playground?
Yeah, in that direction, we're keeping the two travel lanes in that direction.
We heard questions about TD Gardens, the same thing, that last bit. We're not impacting the travel lanes there.
We talked about the hybrid design was something we came up with to provide the protection but still limit the limited number of parking spaces removal. Segways?
We have lots of questions about segways. I believe we have an answer.
They talked about it earlier.
Sounds great, and I hope that makes most people here quite happy. Segways are allowed in the bike lanes. MBTA trolley buses, we're not removing any of the bus stops. Bikes and buses do coexist at times, and they have to wait oftentimes for each other a little bit.
And as I mentioned, what's concerned about how this would affect loading and ballet activity, and as I said, we're proposing to keep those, keep that activity except it will be moved out away from the curb where the parking is.
Hazardous truck route. This project has no bearing on what happens with the hazardous truck route.
Can you just show the screen of the adjusted roadway? So can you show the shot of the three lanes?
Of course.
Yeah. We'll go back.
I had to step out. I'm sorry. Is the two lanes coming from Columbus Park to Charlestown Bridge or not that bridge? Is it from Charlestown?
Two lanes from Columbus Park to the bridge. So Columbus Park is down this way.
Yep.
Two lanes
are coming the other way.
Two lanes that way, one lane this way.
So it's going to be one lane on the side of the park and on the side of...
No, sorry.
Two lanes on the side of the school.
Two lanes on the side of the school.
So Columbus Park is to my back, it's two lanes on that side if I'm driving.
Two lanes on the water side.
Yeah, water
side. One lane on the non-water side. How's that?
Thank you. Perfect.
We don't need to do north and south. The last question we had, someone brought up, hey, in the winter are people biking? Can we remove these in the winter? We looked into it. It's actually not possible to do that once these lines go in. They do go in. Right now, winter biking is about 50% of the spring-summer peak biking. That will go up as well. So that's the end of the presentation, and we do want to hand it over to you all for questions.
One of the presentations you did, you talked about whether or not people were interested in seeing the lanes be colored.
Yes.
And I know it's more expensive, but where's the city on that?
We're open to doing it, but you know it's a maintenance issue. But yep. I'll be the first to say that, and you know after a couple of years, it's going to wear down, and you know we'll have to bring paint all over again. It's something we don't typically do on any other bike lanes in the city, except in situations where you know it's a very odd intersection and it's a very dangerous situation, mm-hmm. like in Kenmore Square and other places, mm-hmm. or maybe at Dewey Square.
Mm-hmm.
But otherwise, we've not picked
it. Actually, if it's something that came out as people people here are strongly in favor of, there are some ways that you can mix mix color into the material on the surface and do a
I talked to public works about it. I'm taking Vinny completely by surprise here.
Is there any data about safety with coloring lanes? Any data that says that?
There is. Mostly it's been studied at conflict points,
okay.
So at intersections. That's where the FHWA has sponsored experiments. They have just issued interim approval in advance of the guidance coming out being revised. Mm-hmm. So there is a safety benefit. We actually recommend it here at intersections where you have conflicts, mm-hmm. so vehicles are really aware of that conflict point.
In overseas, one thing they talk about is how they don't want to overdo it with color,
right?
Because then when you get to this area, it's not standing out. Mm-hmm.
Of course, we talked about in another meeting that area around the Secundus Park, as you're coming from the waterfront, Rose Wharf around, and you take a right there, that's a real dangerous
yeah.
thing. There's not a lot of
And we've identified what we think are conflict points, and we'd obviously want to hear more from everyone.
George?
Yeah, did I see that the statistics was that 2.11% of the population uses bicycles as a means of transport?
That's our current in Boston, 2% of trips, trips made by bike. That's
so
it doubled in the last 3 years.
How much is that?
What'd you say?
How many people is that in Boston, 600,000?
It's a very good question. We're calculating it now. It's tens of thousands every day.
Out of 600,000, tens of thousands, 2% is tens of thousands?
Yes.
Well, so the 2% is just the work trip.
It's 12,000 people, huh?
So that's just the work trip, which is a fraction. So that doesn't include kids riding bikes, doesn't include people biking.
I'm just trying to get a reference point.
Yeah.
We're doing this for about 12,000 people, which is what 2.11% is. The other question that I have is what is the budget and the cost of that, just that section of bike lane, what are we talking about money-wise?
That's a good question. I will be able to answer your question of total numbers later in the summer. We're calculating. It's many tens of thousands. Commute trips.
It can't be many tens of thousands, ma'am.
The average person takes 7 trips per day.
Okay, but anyway, so what's the cost of the just so we know.
On average, it's about 30,000 to 50,000 per mile.
Per mile.
Yeah.
So what are we talking about?
We're looking at probably 30,000 or 40,000.
Just for that section.
Correct, yes.
So you said there's another plan for what's going to happen from Charter Street to North Washington? Because that's a strange.
Go back to the Shero photo. We couldn't lose a travel lane in that section. We know that with Crossroads there's going to be another alternative. So what we're proposing is something that we use a lot throughout the city. It's called a shared lane marking. And we don't do standalone shared lane markings really, but sometimes at a transition, if you can't get the bike lane in, you transition to it. It's very effective in that scenario coming off of the bike lane.
And that'll go all the way to like the Cornell building?
That'll go to the bridge.
It'll connect you to a child, basically, right? Once it goes through, once
well,
you
can... it'll connect you to the bridge. At Causeway Street, a bike lane is in design for that.
This is my second time seeing this presentation. I think it's great, and I voiced my concerns at the first meeting I was at. I think that bike lanes are a great idea. I just don't think the North End is the neighborhood for it. I still have concerns over traffic congestion. Anytime you lose any spots, even if it's one spot in the North End, that's a huge impact on the residents. So now to hear there's 15 to 20 spots being lost, that's a big deal, at least to me, and I'm sure other committee members. And finally, correct me if I'm wrong, but if this was to be done tomorrow, it wouldn't connect to anything currently, right?
We anticipate putting in the Greenway bike lanes this year.
Okay.
And we also have multiple bike lanes going in the downtown area in the next couple of months.
Okay, but as it stands now, it just kind of starts at one part of the North End and then goes to the end. There's no loop or anything like that.
This and the Greenway will go in at the same time. We're also working on Seaport.
Okay.
And Franklin Oliver and High Downtown, which will get you into essentially the Back Bay area.
Right, downtown. But as it stands now, it's just kind of one loop around the outside of the North End.
If you were to put it in today, yes, but by the time you put it in, if you put it in 2 months, it'll be a network.
Okay.
And so we're 2 months shy of anything, no matter what.
Anybody else have any questions? Anybody else have any
Hello. At the last meeting, I asked, question, who's liable for any
accidents? Oh, and I got an answer, thank you. I got an answer from David Watson, who's a lawyer, who's the executive director of Mass Bike. He said it is still, it's not automatically one or the other. no cyclist or pedestrian has insurance, so it's no different. There is no insurance out there for cyclists or pedestrians, so if a cyclist hits a pedestrian, there is no insurance.
So can they sue the city?
They would not, well, they could sue the city, they'll sue everyone they can find. Absolutely, but who knows how effective that would be.
Well,
but car insurance, if a pedestrian said, I think their car insurance would actually cover it.
Well, I think it's an area that it's not going to work. Consider putting it over on the surface road, the area over that way, Concord Street, away from residential driveways, away from residential drivers on the harbor side of Atlantic and Commercial. There are numerous curb cuts, and you think people are going to be patient waiting for these thousands of people to come through who don't know where they are and where this tourists. It's going to be chaos. And if anyone has been down to the waterfront in the past couple of weeks and seen what has been created by the Harbor Island traffic, this is another indication of chaos. Thousands and thousands of people are down, taking boats, getting on boats, getting off boats to go to the Harbor Islands, and it's total chaos.
So you're saying there's a lot of traffic, car traffic?
Pedestrian traffic. Nobody knows which way they're going, what line to get in.
How does that relate to the bike lanes?
The same thing. You got people on a bicycle. They're not going to know where they are. If they're not from the city, they think, oh, this is a great way to see the city, and it's going to cause problems.
Well, let me ask a question.
Let me just finish.
Okay.
I walk every day, twice a day, around the North End, and if you see what's occurring at Urban Adventures bicycle shop, they've taken over the sidewalk. I have to walk out in the street sometimes.
I don't think we have to necessarily blame the city for what Urban Adventures is doing, but what about enhancing tourism and encouraging visitors with maps? Will there be any sort of collateral media, like showing people where this connects to other parts of the city so they kind of
That's a great question. With bikes here, there's two stations in the North End, we have mentioned the others in the Cross Hanover area, and we're looking to relocate it. There are maps at those stations that people can look at. We also have Boston Bikes maps that show all of this. We've put 40,000 a year. They're in every bike shop. A lot of neighborhood groups get them, and we send them out all the time. We think in 6 months, we sent out 25,000 already.
I'll just make a sort of overall blanket comment. I'll be quiet again. I think this is a terrific idea. I do regret losing any parking spaces, but I think that I've been to world-class cities myself overseas that are fantastic bike cities. The entire population of Berlin seemingly is on bikes. It works beautifully. There is not chaos. It integrates well with traffic. Bikers quickly become integrated in how things work. Even foreigners easily bike. I bike through parts of Germany where there are great tourist attractions, bike trails. And I think that this is the way of the future. I think that I wish there was ways we could minimize the parking reduction. But I think every city who's going to aspire to be great, it's going to be a biking city within a very few years. And I hope that we can find a way to make this work. I support it entirely. I would hate to see parking.
Okay, in the interest of time, okay,
yes.
Is there a way, I'm confused. Are we going with the hybrid, or are they voting on which option they see best for the neighborhood? Or is the hybrid option the only option?
The hybrid is the one that has seemed to be most favorable. We're obviously open, there's no definitive anything. It's about the neighborhood. We agree that tourists will use it. We also think it's a lot for folks in the neighborhood.
Hybrid one's the protected lane, right?
Hybrid is the one that is protected on one side, but is a standard bike lane on the other. And the goal was to minimize the parking, but still get the benefits of protection for
people. How many more parking spaces would you lose if you protect it on both sides?
It doubles it, so from 15 to 20 to 30 to 40.
And the city believes that this is a great idea when it comes to just losing parking over bike lanes that are probably going to be used 4 months out of the year by 2.11% of the population. It's just really
yes,
cool.
Yes, the city believes it's a good idea.
That is really a good idea. It's
yes.
Really brilliant.
Do you guys have any indication of people giving up their cars to to, like...
We're getting to numbers. Zipcar actually has those numbers. I feel like it's 18% or is it 40%? Do you know that number? I can get back to it. It's remarkably high with Zipcar. We know a lot of cyclists do still drive, but not as much. And then it adds an option and allows them to all of a sudden say, okay, now I can use public transportation, Zipcar, and bike, and I've got a complete picture and I can get around. We know with bike share, for instance, about 23% of the trips would otherwise have been taken by a personal car. So it's pretty good numbers.
Just want to support that a little bit. We found in our research, I would say anecdotal research, that people living in the downtown areas, while they might own a car, will not drive it every day. They'll drive it on weekends if they're heading out of town or if they have to run errands. But typically, most people who are living downtown are going to work using public transportation. So the number of cars might still be there, but the number of trips starts to reduce when you have alternatives, whether it's a zip car or whether it's a bicycle or whether it's just walking.
I know we have to move this along because we've got two more presentations, but is there any way to not lose the parking space?
Yeah, I just want to qualify something that Nicole had said. We do believe that bicycling is a policy that we'd like to support, but we don't want to put bicycling or bicycle lanes in place at the cost of other things that the community values.
Right.
So that's our philosophy for the city.
Right.
It's not a blanket, bikes is the way to go.
Mm-hmm.
So we do strongly encourage the establishment of bike lanes all over the city. We're putting about 20 to 30 miles a year in different parts of the city. So I just wanted to qualify that statement.
Can I ask you a question?
So is there any way that we can possibly...
Yeah, I think that what we should do is we should go back and look at those 15 to 20 places. Like the last time we met, you said 5 to 8, and I think we really need to look at how the 5 to 8 went to 15 to 20.
I think one of the things we also want to make sure we do is we consider safety. I think that's going to be something we'll have to balance closely at those corners.
What we'll do is we'll sit down and go intersection by intersection, space by space, and we'll have some of our engineers from the department sit with you and try and see what we can do. Yeah.
Before you finish, can you just explain what a bike share is, what it looks like, and how it works? Because I know that you mentioned it twice, but for the sake, because it's going to affect them in some way. So I would prefer them to know what it is.
My question refers to the same thing, too. You said that you're going to have this area of a commercial street, and then you're going to have Greenway.
Correct.
Okay? Since we have two means of getting to the same place, in a sense. You got the waterfront, which is Coast Guard, baseball field, skating rink, the outside of the North End, and you have Greenway, the front side of the North End. Could you perhaps do on Commercial Street, just the regular bike lane marking, okay? And then do the safe option for families as a second option on the Greenway. Instead of doing, what it seems to me you're gonna be doing two safe options. You can have an option for commuters that are on bicycles regularly, which sounds to me is more of the people that are using it because at 2.9% of the population, that really leaves families out. And then you could have an alternative on the Greenway because you're going to be losing parking on the Greenway also.
Great. So I'll answer Nicole's question and then I'll move yours.
Okay.
Michelle, in the meantime, you go back to the network photos or future.
And we really do have to move this along.
What bike share is, it's automated bike stations. So you can swipe a credit card, you get a bike. What's magical about it is you can return it to any other station. When Paris launched, they were just like Boston. Not a bike-friendly city. They had 54 million trips taken by bike in 2 years. These were not cyclists. We call it Zipcar on steroids. You don't need a reservation ahead of time. You can return it anywhere you want, and it gets the average person on bikes. It's a very, very cool thing. To answer your question, and we're looking at two stations in the North End.
And then 40 feet long.
Right? 40, 50 feet long.
And they'll be on the sidewalk, and they'll have the bike, so they need about 6 feet wide. So the station comes out this far, and then the bike goes in, and then the tire comes. So.
And we'll chat about that. So you had your question. What we are planning actually is on the Greenway here, a bike lane. And it has some protection actually from the parked cars because there's so many trolleys. So it's a similar style protected type bike lane on the water side as here. There's no space for a bike lane in this portion. And this is actually quite a dangerous section. even now, it's very rare for cyclists to go out of the way to get somewhere, but even now, if you look at cyclists going northbound, they already do go out of the way to get up there. It's shocking, I've never seen people go out of the way. They take Mass Ave before any other alternative. But this is really the route, and it is sort of the only route to get up there that has potential to be safe.
I cycle, I never take that road. I never take the hallway. I cycle, I take the shoreway.
Yeah. Nicole, you seem to be fine, oh, sorry, can you finish?
Yeah.
You seem to be fine-tuning this time you do the presentation. When do you when do you anticipate implementing this, and when will the public know what your final plan is?
That's a good question. I usually look to Vineet for a green light, red light, what does the community feel? We meet internally.
Yeah, I think what you heard is a fairly good, I think they've done the analysis. Right?
Okay.
And I made it clear that you should tell us exactly how many spaces you're going to lose. It. So that's what we're hearing, 15 to 20. I'm going to go back, we're going to sit with the engineers, and I'll make a commitment that we'll maybe not come back to a meeting like this, but at least that.
You can at least send me a letter.
Send you a letter saying that this is what it's going to be. These are the spaces, and can we actually locate precisely where the spaces will be lost?
Yes, we would do a detailed, we would lay out the whole street and do a detailed plan.
So we'll say you're losing, 15 spaces at XYZ addresses, or we'll give you a map.
And just so you know, they're pretty evenly dispersed.
Generally, you're losing a space per block. Two spaces per block.
Like at every intersection type.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I just want to say one thing. What's that?
Intersection and driveway.
Yep. If you're getting input from the community and you want to know what the temperature in the neighborhood is, I want to just state what my opinion is, how I feel, and that is I support bike lanes. I don't care how many spots we lose, to be honest with you. And I have a truck that I drive every day and I park every night, and if we lose 40 spaces, we lose 40 spaces.
And 40.
Would you consider having parking spaces and garages to make up for lost space? Do you know how that would work?
I can't promise that you'll be able to do that. No.
Great thought, but that probably won't happen. Anybody else? Anybody from the council? Thank you so much. That was very informative. We appreciate it. Good luck with it.
Thank you all, especially those that have worked together many times.
No, thank you.